Welcome, guys, to the second edition of Pony Battles, where we take a look at the My Little Pony comic lines. If you missed the last episode of Pony Battles, check out the Pony Battles playlist. Say that 5 times fast. In the old channel hub, seeing that I don't like doing annotations because, well, they take too much of my time. But let's cut the crap out and get straight to the second main arc in the series, Nightmare Rarity. Now, I make no secrets. I hate Rarity. I hate Rarity with a such burning, firing passion that even Michael Cole deserves more of my mercy than this little pony. She's arrogant, selfish, derivative, downright slave driving, and could use a comeuppance or two. And finally in this comic, she finally gets to be the character that I've always envisioned in my mind. Just an evil, manipulative son of a tank. Coming off of the return of Queen Chrysalis, you would think it's an excellent start for the comic series. But I'm here to tell you, excellent start doesn't automatically mean excellent follow-up. Remember the old saying in movies, the sequel is never better than the original. And in this case, that applies. The storyline takes us with Harmony 6 having bad dreams, and boy have we all been there. But these bad dreams seem to be specific about their worst fears in life. Twilight being dismissed from Twilestia, although in my opinion that might actually be a good thing. Rainbow Dash unable to fly with the Wonderbolts, Fluttershy not being able to hang out with animals, Applejack losing the farm, and so on and so on. Well, Rarity's dreams, however, take a much deeper context. It's not only the fear that her designs won't sell, it's the fear of the out-and-out forgetfulness and rejection of the people of Bonyville that has hurt a tizzy at night, which isn't really all that great for a minute, and only a sheer minute do I sympathize with Rarity's concerns. Pinkie Pie, after having a bad day of just everybody running into everybody, Buddy Rainbow Dash giving Twilight a light speed clothesline from hell in the middle of Ponyville, Bill manages to come up with a great idea, and all get together slumber party. Well, this would work, except the nightmares strike again. And even worse, they have a form now. And they just so happen to snatch up Rarity and take her straight to the moon. Twilight and of course the others concerned about their friend decide to give Celestia a holler, in which she is actually light speed in her response. But also, Twilight thinks about Luna could possibly aid the situation. That in which she does. But she goes about expositing a big legend about what she calls the Nightmare Forces. Shall we figures that with their magical power, transformed her into Nightmare Moon. Now, if this sounds contradictory to the main show's canon, then yes, it should and it does. But I am one of the rare believers that believes a combination of the two may be in play here. Yes, it is semi by choice, with the Nightmare Forces giving Luna their power in exchange for a shot at the old world domination game. Luna decides to help them out, mainly by lassoing the moon and bringing it closer to Earth. Huh, I guess in a magical world anything works. So our intrepid team of six make their way to the moon, with Spike, of course, coming along because Rarity Crush. But it's actually quite adorable here. In fact, Spike is one of the highlights of this comic set, seeing that the entire storyline of Spike's crush, including Secret of My Excess, in which the jewel that was given to him is worn proudly around his neck throughout the entire comic arc, is a really nice touch. But once they get there, the Nightmare Forces are of course waiting on them, and the comic implies that they're without the elements of harmony, which would make sense seeing that they are pretty much the lights of Orion, and they only work when all six of them are together, except for a part of plot contrivance in Book 4 of the arc, which I'll get to. It's not before the Nightmare Forces try to take the other five. But thanks to some proper motivation, each of them is kicked out of their nightmare funk. But not before they're captured. Spike being the only one capable of saving them, sets off to save his friends and runs headlong into the newest opponent, Nightmare Rarity. Yes, it's Rarity, only finally, as she should be, an overly manipulative, ultimately self-centered, ultimately evil villain. You see, Rarity could play the villain card in this show / comic more beautifully than she does a hero, and quite frankly, her self-centeredness is not played for laughs and giggles here, and it's perfectly played well. The only drawback is, well, her flunkies and the Nightmare Forces, known to many of the Brony community as the Nightmare Shadows, aren't really all that interesting. And that's the downplay. Yes, they have the Xana effect of just being creepy, manipulative, and downright spooky, but they don't really do anything massively evil except try to take over Ponyville. Who doesn't? Ponyville is the new Angel Grove. There, I said it. But Celestia is at the ready with all town having her back. Luna, of course, was sent back via Twilight's behest, and now they're in a dungeon. But leave it to Pinkie Pie's random percent, another plot contrivance, to get them out of it. And leave it to the two flunkies, as well as two main flunkies, as well as all the other henchmen in the Nightmare Shadows to be complete stupid idiots. What is it with henchmen and being idiots? Well, it's off to that plot contrivance I brought up earlier. Twilight manages to think about how crazy but enjoyable her friendships are, and all of a sudden the remaining five elements can all of a sudden go Super Saiyan and channel their elemental powers. Huh. Another stupid, continuity-breaking plot convenience. It can't get any more worse, can it? Well, not really, seeing that we're finally to the main part of this arc. Luna, having to come to grips with her former identity and what she did as it. Throughout the entire arc, she is slowly realizing she's got friends and backup despite of her past, and she finally learns the value of facing your innermost personal fear, and ultimately, thanks to the elements, gets that uber nice star sparkling hairstyle we have come to know the Princess of the Night for. She blasts the shadows away, and the day is ultimately saved. Rarity being saved by the memories of her friendship over the course of the time of the show in the comics. But many people, including Tommy Oliver, see this as another plot contrivance, seeing that how was Luna under much deeper control and Rarity so much easier? Well, I have a theory on that. You see, the theory goes like this. Rarity, being a much weaker unicorn, was obviously more easy to straight up take over and give pure force to, rather than Luna, who had the pure force of an alicorn, but the personal thoughts of being evil, thus creating a much more evil magical grip. And that's why the elements had to be used to wipe the control away in the first place. But that's just my thought on it. Overall, the artwork is great, but not as great as the previous work. And the writing can massively be improved. Characters mostly Rainbow Dash and Applejack are kind of acting crazy here. I wouldn't say out of character, just a little bit crazy. And the Nightmare Shadows being not as evil as they could be really lessens the blow here. But Luna's redemption combined with Spike's excellent portrayal in this book, hell, he should be portrayed more like this in the main series, not just here in the comics. But even both of those things don't save this set of books from being average, but still a good, fun, entertaining read. That's why the Nightmare Rarity arc gets a 6 out of 10. Or, in the case of the 6 harmony scale a 3 out of a possible 6. Do not pass this up if you're a Luna fan or if you're a Spike fan. There's a lot to enjoy here, but if you're looking for a truly evil threat and a truly gripping set of books, you're not gonna find it here, unfortunately. It's just not strong enough. And it's mainly because of the writer of the art, too. That's kind of the sad part. But next time on Phony Panels, we do a little something different, and we take it to a different place, as Big Macintosh takes the stage? Sorta. Be here next time on Pony Panels when we talk about Zen and the Art of Gazebo Repair. Just let that name juggle through your brain a bit. Find peace in your own nirvana.